Hey guys, welcome to another Friday video. We are back with the LGA 2011 platform, and today we're looking at a very balanced processor. This is one of my favorites. It's the E5-2650V2. This is an 8-core 16-thread processor, and it's got a nice balance, a decent price, excellent performance. The clock speed is high enough for most games, and the price is also fairly decent. At the time of making this video, you're looking at $62. As always, in this video, we will take a closer look at the processor and the specifications, but there's more to building a system than just having the processor. You need a mainboard, RAM, and other bits and pieces. And the mainboard is especially interesting. With the 2011 platform, which is now 5, 6, 7 or so years old, you can go with a used Asus or Gigabyte mainboard, but they can cost quite a bit on eBay. They're still holding on to their value. So the Chinese are building brand new mainboards. So you might be wondering, why are they doing that? Well, they have a ton of old server processors. They have a ton of old server memory. So they're building these motherboards to bundle them up and shift old stock. So let's take a closer look at the processor. It is for LGA 2011. We have 8 cores and 16 threads. It's built on the Ivy Bridge generation, built on 22 nanometer process technology. We've got a whopping 20 megabytes of level 3 cache. The base clock is only 2.6 gigahertz, but in games, the all-core turbo is 3 gigahertz, and that seems to be enough for most modern games. Every now and then we will see a single thread run a little bit higher even. We have a quad channel DDR3 memory interface supporting 1866 megahertz. We have a 95 watt TDP, and at the time of making this video, this processor sells for $62 on AliExpress. And we need a LGA 2011 mainboard, and I've bought quite a few of these mainboards on AliExpress. So far, my favorite is the Plex HD Turbo, and I will put some affiliate links down below in the description if you're interested. So this is one of the nicer mainboards. It does have its quirks, and there are a couple of things that don't work that you should be aware of. But let's start talking about the positives first. So we have quad channel memory. We've got some decent VRAM cooling. We've got a ton of PCI Express slots. Two 16X, we got two 1X, and that's a 4X actually. It's not connected up to a 16X. We've got a diagnostic LED, reset and power buttons directly on the PCB. It has USB 3 front headers and also USB 3 ports at the back. So some of the downsides, we only get one SATA 3 port, the other ones are SATA 2. The sleep mode doesn't work, and the BIOS is extremely basic and limited. And overclocking is also, well, you can't overclock with the locked processors. You need to get an unlocked CPU, and then you can't raise the voltage, and even the max multiplier is limited. So the BIOS is extremely basic. There's not much you can do. There are no BIOS updates, and little things like mentioning SLI here and the motherboard not being SLI compatible. But all in all, you're looking at around $80 for such a board. And yeah, is it something you should rush out and buy? Well, that depends really on your market. Where do you live? What are the prices on used hardware? For me, it's more about playing around with high-end hardware from yesterday, seeing what we can do, and having a bit of cheap fun, basically. But yeah, if you live in the US or in Australia next to Micro Center or MSY, then something like this might not make a lot of sense, but this might be more for entertainment and because it's interesting. At the back, we have the usual ports, two PS2, we've got six USB 2, two USB 3, gigabit Ethernet, and audio. RAM is really cheap, and that's because we can use server memory, also called registered ECC DDR3 memory. You're looking at around $60 for a 32 gigabyte RAM kit, but keeping the price low, I went with a 16 gigabyte RAM kit. You should get one for around $30 or so. And this is rated at 1866. However, out of the box, the BIOS set the speed to 1600. There is an option to force a higher memory speed, so that's what I've done. The video card we're using today is the Radeon RX 5700. This is probably outside of the budget considering the other parts, But it was kind of a necessary investment into the channel. It lets me test at 1080p so we get better graphics and avoid any bottleneck situations. I'm still curious how the Radeon RX 5500 will shape up, what sort of performance we're going to see, and especially what the price will be like. But at the time of making the decision to buy this video card, there weren't too many options and I really wanted to stick with a Radeon. So yeah, this basically lets us test a 1080p while still avoiding any bottlenecks so we can see what the processor and what the system can do when paired with a decent video card. We're once again using the Thermaltake 750 watt power supply. I measured the power consumption sitting idle on the desktop, only 51 watts. That's the entire machine with the video card, storage and everything. And running Cinebench R20, I saw a peak reading of 113 watts. So this system is pretty energy efficient. The processors don't come with a cooler, so you will definitely need to get one. A lot of cheaper coolers are not compatible with 2011, so that's something you have to look out for. I really like this model. It screws directly onto the socket. It's got a smaller fan, 92 millimeters, but the cooling performance is excellent. Now, there's also the famous Snowman cooler. Apparently there are two versions, one with four and one with five heat pipes. I've got the version with four. Seems to work really well. I had a bit of an issue. The mounting pressure on this one is very high. And I used these thermal pads rather than thermal paste. And unfortunately, it tore a piece out of it. So I had to order new thermal pads from Amazon. So for this video, I went back to using thermal paste. And that worked just fine. And for storage, I'm still using two 1TB SSDs from KingSpec in a StarTech RAID 0 enclosure. Still waiting for decent prices or specials on 2TB SSDs. If you see anything, do leave a comment down below. I definitely want to upgrade. The performance on these SSDs are not too bad, but in RAID 0, the performance with small files is actually quite bad. So that's an area I definitely want to improve on. Let's have a quick look at some benchmarks and then we're gonna check out some games. So we've got Cinebench R15, we're getting 1050. Cinebench R20, we're getting 2267. And the Blender benchmark completed in 32 minutes and 43 seconds. And now let's have a look at some games. We're starting off with some games from Microsoft, from the Xbox PC Pass. It's only $5 or $6 a month and you get access to a range of games. And for the purpose of, yeah, being a content creator, this is actually great. So it gives me access to some of the newer games that I usually don't buy because they cost quite a bit of money. So first up, we have Dirt Rally 2. Beautiful graphics, and we're running a 1080p with high details, and we're getting well above 100 FPS. So this game seems to be able to take advantage of all the cores and threads, and doesn't need a super high clock speed. Another racing game that just got added to the Xbox Pass catalog is F1 2018. And here also 1080p high details over 100 FPS. So that's another modern-ish game that seems to be running really well. And of course, I had to try Metro Exodus also on the Xbox Pass store. Here we're running with ultra details, but I turned off all the NVIDIA stuff because we're using a Radeon card. But for some reason, VSync seems to be locked. I turned it off in the settings, but the FPS was capped at 60. But it held the performance locked. So ultra details, 1080p, locked 60 FPS performance. That is pretty good. And we have one more game from the Xbox Pass store, Forza Horizon 4. Here the MSI Afterburner overlay wouldn't work, so it's using a built-in FPS counter. And once again, we're getting over 100 FPS. I'm using the high preset. I disabled any of the dynamic quality optimizations and that sort of stuff. So looks good, runs good. So overall, if you are a fan of these games, yeah, I can highly recommend signing up for the Xbox Pass. There are awesome games on there, and it seems that this processor has the performance to run those games really well. Let's have a look at a game that usually struggles a little bit with the processors that have a low clock speed. It's Far Cry 5, and here we are getting just around the 60 FPS mark, But sometimes it does dip below, and that's because the all-core turbo is only 3 GHz. So Far Cry 5 is a game where you want the processor around the 4 GHz mark to have a bit of a buffer to be over the 60 FPS. It is still fairly playable, and the video card is not the bottleneck here. You can look at the utilization, it's well under 100%. So this is a game where the processor, especially the clock speed, is holding things back. So just keep that in mind. It's something I've been seeing with Ubisoft games across the board. They're just not that well optimized for machines with more cores and a lower clock speed. The Witcher 3 is always a good test. And here, once again, we're getting high FPS. But I keep seeing these frame time stutters. I'm still not sure what is going on. It might be storage, but then the machine has plenty of RAM, so I'm not sure what's going on, because I get comments from you guys that this is unusual, but I've been seeing this issue now on several machines, so maybe it is storage. And yeah, like I said earlier, if you see a good price, a good deal on a 2 TB SSD, do let me know. It's definitely something I want to invest in. Battlefield 1 is next. We're getting over 100 FPS. This is with high details, and we are on a multiplayer 64 player map. So this is a good representation of what the performance will be like on this machine. And yep, runs good, looks good, very happy. Shadow of the Tomb Raider is another game that runs well on this machine, even in some of the more demanding areas. We have plenty of cores and threads, and this is a game that can take advantage of it. In most situations, you're actually limited by the video card, so it's nice to have the RX 5700 now, and at 1080p with high details, we're getting above 60 FPS pretty much at all times. But do keep in mind, I'm using only the demo version, and I can only test what's in that version. So there might be areas in the full game that are a little bit more demanding, but in most areas, you should still get decent performance. Apex Legends seems to be running very well. I cranked up all the details, so everything is maxed out. We're getting over 100 FPS, it seems, when running around. And I don't think I saw it dip below 60 at any point. So Apex Legends, if this is a game you're enjoying, then yep, you can put together a cheap budget machine using this processor. I also had a look at Fortnite, and I'm seeing a similar trend with this game. The FPS figures are high, but we keep getting frame time spikes, and I'm not quite sure what it is and what I can do to tune that. But when playing such a competitive game, having spikes and little stutters can definitely be distracting and is not something you want to see. So I'm not sure if the software is at fault, if the game needs to be optimized more better, or if there's some weakness with the machine. Considering it runs all the other games fairly smooth, Fortnite always puzzles me a little bit. So that's a great budget PC, but does it run Crysis? And unfortunately, it does not. So the clock speed is too low. We are getting FPS well below 60. And for a game that's that old, it is really disappointing. So Crysis is unfortunately a game that's not optimized at all. You need a processor running at around 4 GHz, maybe even higher. Or yeah, like a 3rd-gen Ryzen would be nice. That CPU will probably run the entire game 60 FPS locked. So that's something to look forward in a few years when Ryzen 4 or 5 is out. Then we can look at the 3rd generation. And yeah, so Crysis, unfortunately, still to this day, a very demanding game. So guys, let's talk about the value, the risks, prices, and all of that. So $62. And look, prices can always change. If YouTubers make a video on prices and parts on AliExpress, sometimes they do jack up the prices, so just keep that in mind. But at the time of making the video, the processor was $62. I do know that a few months ago it was more around the $70 to $80, and then the value, yeah, it's not that good anymore. But for $62, the performance we saw is excellent. The RAM is also extremely cheap, and that's the highlight of the LGA 2011 platform. 32 gig for $60, that's amazing. For gaming, just spend $30 on a 16 gig RAM kit and you're laughing, and the performance is excellent. The make or break is usually with the mainboard. You have to be aware that you're buying something from China. It's unsupported. If there are any issues, good luck trying to get a warranty or get support with the warranty. The BIOS is extremely limited. there won't be any BIOS update. So just keep that in mind. And the sleep mode is also not working, and there's some quirks like only one SATA 3 port, and some of the, for example, this one here has, it doesn't have an M.2 slot, but it runs at half the speed, only on a times 2, not a times 4, so you're losing a bit of speed. So little quirks like that are quite common with these main boards. But I'm using a LGA 2011 platform system as my main daily driver. I've got an overclockable processor in that machine running at 4 gigahertz. And for me, having 32 gig RAM for a cheap price, that was one of the highlights. And yeah, it's also about putting my money where my mouth is and building something that I recommend to you guys and using it. And I had no issues. I do all my video editing on that machine. So yeah, I do stand behind these products, but I am aware that they are not for everyone. And if you don't like the risk, just get something locally. First gen Ryzen, excellent value at the moment. Good luck finding a local 2011 motherboard for $80. It's gonna get difficult. Also something to look forward in a future video. I have bought a 2011 mainboard for $50. So I'm really looking forward to seeing what that can do. And yeah, looking for all the quirks. I've been working with a few mainboards now, so I know pretty much what to look for to find the weaknesses. So that's something I'm really looking forward to doing. So guys, as always, the value comes down to where you live, what parts you have access to, what the shipping costs are like. I live in a remote regional Australian town. Everything has to be posted. And if I buy stuff locally from computer stores, either in Perth or East Coast, yeah, it costs $20, $30, $40, $50 of postage on top of the price, and then the savings are out the window. Whereas that's not an issue with AliExpress. The postage is included in the price. Absolutely, you're still paying for it. It's just part of the price. And the downside is you have to wait 4 or 5 weeks, depending on where you live. If I was living on the East Coast, the shipping would be probably 2 weeks less. Unfortunately, it goes to the East Coast first, then goes to the West, and then up north to where I live, and that alone takes like a week or another 2 weeks of time. But yeah, that just means I have to plan things out a little bit in advance, and I can't react very quickly with a follow-up video if I'm missing a part, for example. But yeah, so guys, we are at the end of the video. So once again, it just shows how little progress processors have made, and that you can pick up something that's 5, 6, 7 years old and still get decent performance. That was totally different in the old days, like early 90s and something like that, where the performance just exploded, going from a 386 to a 486 to a Pentium. You couldn't use a 6-year-old computer to do anything. It was just it was a toaster, basically. And that's changed, and that's really interesting and exciting. Bit disappointed with the video cards. Really hoping that someone just releases a real value killer that we can just recommend. Something around a $200 mark that is twice as fast as the last generation. That's really what I was hoping for. But hopefully with the RX 5500, yeah, it depends on the price. Either way, we will find out soon, I guess. And as always, guys, leave any suggestions and comments down below in the comments. I read every single comment. And that's it. Thank you for watching. If you found this video interesting, be sure to subscribe if you haven't done so already. Give it a like, leave a comment, share the video with your friends, and I shall see you soon with another one.